Hi everybody, Matt and Tom back with you. Today we're in Manchester and we've come to have a look around, let's call it Manchester's party village. We're on Canal Street and this is officially classed as Manchester's gay village. What we're going to do today is we're going to walk up and down the streets of the village, show you what's here. We're going to do some history as we go, and yeah, it's just going to be one of those that comes out spuriously, I think. Now, we can't cover every single club and bar here. It's impossible. So if you watch this and go, he hasn't done this one, apologies. But we'll do what we can. Let's see what's here.
In the 19th century, this was a busy area for the cotton industry. Manchester provided 30% of the world's cotton. Being next to the canals, that was how trade kept moving. When transport changed, so did Canal Street. The area became deserted and even became a red light district. However, in this century, it's known as being one of the safer locations for the LGBTQ plus community, thanks to the gay village. However, it's not always been like this. Even in the 1990s, some of the bars in this area had to have blacked out windows to stop them being raided by the police. The gay community has always been persecuted from small-minded members of the public, but also the police force. In 1967, homosexuality was decriminalised, so anything before 55 years ago, it was illegal to be anything other than straight. However, there have certainly been improvements in the last 40 years. 1985 saw the first Manchester Pride. Canal Street saw its first openly gay bar open in the 1990s, followed by nightclubs like Cruise 101. 25 years, 30 years later, Manchester's gay quarter is world famous. So we'll just briefly tell you about some of the clubs and pubs that are here, literally, briefly. So for example, here is Oscar's Bar. This one's a bit of a different kind of bar. It's a theatre-style cocktail bar. It shows film clips from classic and modern musicals and is obviously slightly different to the frequent nightclubs on the street. Sadly, there are some tragic tales from Canal Street as well. One we'll get to a little bit later, but there is a plaque on the bridge here for Matthew Perrin, who died in 2001 and whose body was found in the canal.
So this is On Bar, and this one was one of the first nightclubs on Canal Street, but it was originally called Mantos. And the reason it was very different, and I'll come up here so I don't get run over, is unlike the other clubs and pubs in the area, this one had bigger windows and they weren't afraid for people to come past and look at what was going on inside. Plus they had the balcony, open air balcony. So yeah, this one is almost responsible for everything else that followed all the other nightclubs here. Manto, do you remember it? So the angel wings on the new Union Hotel have replaced the Batman and Superman kiss that was there for a few years. Seemed to start a little trend across the world. Cheeky Batman. So this one is the new Union Hotel, formerly known as the Union Hotel. And this was built in 1865. And it's been a gay venue for almost the entire time it's been here. In the 1940s, The Union hosted drag shows for American troops stationed in Manchester. And in the 1950s, the owner was jailed for apparently running a house of ill repute. So this one, as I've said, is quite an old pub here on Canal Street. And the difference to the others is to do with the windows. So back in the past, when, you know, homosexuality was illegal, when things were going on in there, they wouldn't see when they came past. The windows are all kind of faded out, so you couldn't actually look inside. That's the reason they look like that. So what's the image of that? Oh, the little cottage.
Yeah.
Okay, the next street over from Canal Street is Richmond Street. Obviously it looks a little bit different. Let's see what's down here.
When you're in Manchester, wherever you are, always look out for the street art. And this is just an example of it here on the right hand side. This is, of course, Divina da Campo, and I don't think Tom noticed it. And here's just a bit of a fling back to the past. I imagine all the streets here looked like that at some point. This one's the former, obviously now former, Vanilla nightclub. This was a lesbian nightclub that opened in 1998. It was often described as the lesbian mecca of the north. This is what it looked like. Further down we find the street art, which is actually the largest piece of LGBT street art in the UK. These are five LGBT icons at the top. Anaphylactic, Fufu Lamar at the right hand side, Emily Pankhurst, and at the bottom Quentin Crisp and Alan Turing. And there on the side of the Molly House, which describes itself as a place for the discerning, eccentric and alternative. It's a former tailor's shop, opened as a bar and cafe in 2010. In the 18th century, a Molly House was a name given to gay bars where men could meet without fear of prosecution and hanging. This is the back of the Brewers Club, but it used to be the Void nightclub, an underground clubbing bar. It had a lot of negative press in its last few years of life. Lots of violence and tragedy. There was once a hit and run outside the club as well. I think it kind of fizzled out about 2016. Next, we're on to Bloom Street, and although it's no longer here and currently behind these boards, this was the location of the Equinox Club. The Equinox described itself, not specifically gay or straight, and had a policy of admitting pretty boys, pretty girls, eccentrics, and outrageous fashion victims of all ages, colours and sexualities. To the left, we next have the fantastic Eagle Bar. This is a members-only bar and nightclub that opened in 2008. This one caters to those who may have more of a fetish itch to scratch. They have leather rubber nights, which all take place downstairs, alongside sneaker nights, sportswear and more. There's also a Sunday service here each week. Quite recently, even Samantha Mumba performed here. I'm only happy when it rains.
Of what had happened, 2 a.m. death leap, and they described how the policeman and everybody else had come to clean the floor so that nobody got in contact with his blood, in case it was kind of blood was toxic and he had illnesses, etc. You know what they were getting at there, and he didn't even have that. So what happened then, there was a lot of anger, and they set up what's called the Albert Kennedy Trust just a few months later, and that's a group that look after kind of homeless gay and lesbian children, teenagers, put them into care with caring families. So from tragedy came something, you know, something positive.
So this is actually the description put in the Manchester Evening News in 1989. 2 a.m. death leap. Body was found on the early Saturday morning by a policeman. A rent boy carrying a killer disease plunged to his death in the red light district. The firemen washed down the street where the teenager was found to ensure no one came into contact with his blood. Amazing, isn't it? Just creates such anger even today. But the Albert Kennedy Trust, or today it's called AKT, still goes strong after all these years and has helped support hundreds of young people in finding homes as they've been victimised by their families for being gay. Right, quick whiz through some more pubs and clubs. Let's start with Napoleon's, the oldest gay nightclub in Manchester. This bar opened in 1941 and was owned by the famous drag queen Fufu Lamar. We have the Village Fish and Chip Shop on the left. This is Centre Stage. Set to be an old-fashioned venue. Serves up camp cabaret and nostalgic tunes. New York, New York now. So good, they named it twice.
So now we're on Abingdon Street, and at the top of here is another nightclub that opened in 1992, I think. It's called Cruise 101, and it's more famous than any of the others here due to its appearance on a certain TV show in the 90s.
So this is Cruise 101, an old textile warehouse, which opened in 1992. The club became famous when the exterior of it was used in the Channel 4 series Queer as Folk in 1999, which was a series about the lives of a group of gay men living and socialising in the Manchester gay village. The club in the series was called Babylon. It's the largest and longest running club in the village. The iconic bar was previously a hairdressing salon called Tyler Fraser before becoming a bar in 2010. Apparently it's the place to be for gin lovers, and they have 150 varieties available. And previously just known as Icon. Also back on Canal Street, we missed out GAY. This is described as the nightclub to go to if you love fluorescent pink whistles and cowboy hats. And it's aimed at a younger crowd than some of the others. The Richmond Tea Rooms are Manchester's Alice in Wonderland themed tea rooms. The interior is inspired by Lewis Carroll's fantasy world. It's open during the day, but they also host Mad Hatter's Tea Party events, which are for over 18s only. Hosted by the Mad Hatter, I guess.
So now we're in Sackville Gardens. There's a few things here to show you. However, there is a lot fenced off and there are some tours going on. So if we don't manage to get near, I'll just take some pictures of what's here and voice over.
This is the Tree of Life. Next to it is the Beacon of Hope statue, which is a memorial for people affected by HIV and AIDS. It's a steel column perforated with hearts and has been here since 1997. Next to that is one of Manchester's bees. This one is called the Queen Bee.
Okay, so sorry we can't get up close and film Alan Turing's statue. There are tours on and it's very busy around there today. However, that is our look at Manchester's gay village. We do have one more extra place to show you though, and if you ever visit in Manchester, it's one of those rite of passage places that you'd have to go to. And I bet you already know where I'm on about. Let's go and have a quick look at Affleck's Palace.
So as we head to Affleck's back the same way, apologies you didn't get the full outfit experience today of what I hope to wear. However, it's minus 5 degrees, so apologies. And if you've not been to Affleck's before, you've missed a treat. It's 3 floors indoors of a quirky shopping emporium. So what we'll do, we'll just wander around with the camera, film a little bit so you get a taste of what's here. Thank you.
Okay, so that's just a quick look around some of Affleck's Palace. We haven't been able to show you everything. And also people have got back their own artwork and stuff, so they don't want people taking pictures. Better come here and see it for yourself. However, Tom has managed to find a beautiful shirt. Amazing. Right, guys, we shall see you next week somewhere else. Not here. Take care. Bye for now.